Hello students, a very good morning to all. In the last video, we started with the unit 1 of your syllabus, that is atomic structure. We started with the basics to atomic structure. In this video, we'll be covering the first two topics, that is idea of de Broglie method waves and Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So let's get started. In the last video, we calculated we were discussing the Bohr model of atom, where he gave six postulates. Based upon that, we calculated the radius given by him, that was called as Bohr radius of atom, velocity of the electron in the first Bohr orbit, and associated kinetic energy of the electron in Bohr orbit, and potential energy, and further total energy was calculated. Now, based upon this total energy formula, this is the formula for total energy, that is minus 13.6 z square divided by n square. Here, if we put the value of n as 1, that is the case of first Bohr orbit, where n is equal to 1, that is the first orbit. And for hydrogen atoms, that is also 1. So the value of total energy comes out to be minus 13.6 electron volt per atom. So based upon that, here energies have been calculated for hydrogen atom for different Bohr orbits. Here the value of n is equal to 1 and the energy comes out to be for the first Bohr orbit is minus 13.6 electron volt. When n is equal to 2, it comes out to be minus 3.4 electron volt and so on. And once the n becomes infinity, that means the total energy is approaching 0. What does this indicate? That means if we are finding the energy of the electron at infinite distance from the nucleus, then the electron is having zero energy. That means it has ionized the electron. So based upon the sixth point of Bohr orbit, hydrogen spectrum problem was solved, which was the drawback of the Rutherford model. In the hydrogen spectrum, the discrete lines were observed, which was called as discrete spectra, or we call it as line spectra. Let us see this. If we provide energy to the gas molecules contained in a container, what will happen? The energy, the electrons present in different energy levels will gain energy as energy is being supplied either in the form of heat or in the form of electromagnetic radiation. Here, I have shown that energy is being supplied in the form of heat. So some of the radiations will come out. Those electrons, the electron always want to stay in its ground state, the lowest energy level. So what will happen once the electrons gain energy? They will radiate the extra energy gained by them and come to the ground state. So in this process, while coming to the ground state, they will radiate energy, and this energy will be observed on the screen, and it was observed that the spectrum obtained out of these radiations was not continuous, it was discrete. So this discrete spectrum of hydrogen atom was explained by Bohr. The wavelength associated, as this was the emission spectrum means that we are measuring the spectral lines, we are noticing the spectral lines when the energy is being emitted after it is gained by the electrons while coming from the excited state to the ground state. This thing we have already discussed in the sixth point of the Bohr postulates, that electrons can also gain or lose energy. If it gains energy, that means it will jump to the higher energy level. If it loses energy, that means it will come to the lower energy level. So the energy associated with the radiation, the wavelength produced, is related to the wavelength of the radiation produced with this formula. This is energy is equal to 12375 divided by lambda, where lambda is the wavelength of the radiation produced and the units are electron volts. So say if electron is jumping from energy level 2 to energy level 1. If we want to calculate change in energy from N2 to N1, what will happen? This is the formula for energy. Hc by lambda would be equal to, this is the formula of total energy given by Fohr, minus 13.6 Z square by N square. Here it is written for N2 and here it is written for N1. Both belong to the, both are the two orbits of hydrogen atom. So Z is going to be 1. And ultimately, this constant which comes here is called as Rydberg's constant. It is represented by a capital R. Its value is 1.09 into 10 to the minus 7 meter inverse. Also, further we'll be using the value we'll be using this equation to calculate the value of lambda. So we can memorize there in that formula, it will appear as 1 by R. So we can, you can also memorize the value of 1 by R. It is 911 angstrom. So from here, 1 by lambda, or we can say wave number, as 1 by lambda is equal to wave number, this is the symbol of wave number, that is mu bar. It is equal to R z square 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square, where R is Rydberg's constant. Now, next thing observed by Bohr was that energy was not coming out in the form of single radiation, but there were series of radiations. And after that, after the series, first there were series of radiation, and these series of radiations form packets of energy. And after a packet of energy, there was a gap in between the spectrum, and then there was next packet. This can be, this will be more clear to you if you, if we look at this diagram. These are the different energy levels, different energy shells of the hydrogen atom. This represents the energy of first orbit. This represents the energy of second orbit. We have just put the value of Z as 1 and value of N are mentioned here. So here we can see that energy gap between different levels is decreasing as we are moving up. As the value of N is increasing, energy gap between different levels is decreasing, between different energy shells is decreasing. That means shells are being more closely placed. And Bohr observed that whenever electron jumps back to the ground level from either of the higher levels, if it is jumping back from N2 or N3 or N4 or N5 or N6, then these radiations were considered as one packet. And the series of lines obtained from these radiations was called as Lyman series, where the destination was N1 and electron was jumping back from any higher energy shell. Similarly, when electron's final destination was second shell, that is N1 was 2 and N2 can be any higher shell, the series was called as Balmer series. Next series, where the ground state, the destination level was 3 and it was coming back from any higher level, though that series was called as Paschen series. Next was bracket for N1 is equal to 4. For N1 is equal to 5, the series was Pfund. And for N1 is equal to 6, the series was called as Humphrey series. Here N1 stands for the level to which the electron is coming back from various energy levels, where N2 is varying and N1 is fixed for these series. So when N1 is fixed, if N1 is 1, that series was called as Lyman series. And the wavelength of this Lyman series can be calculated using this formula. This I have already shown you. So lambda can be calculated from here. Energy can be calculated from here using this formula. Here energy is related to wavelength. And if we are calculating wavelength from here, and now we know the value of wavelength, then using this formula, we can calculate the energy, well, energy associated with the radiation. So for the first series, we'll get a range of wavelengths which are forming the Lyman series, and the wavelength varies from 911 angstrom to 1216 angstrom. This falls in the UV range. And after that, there is a gap, and due to this gap, the spectrum was discrete. And after each series, there was gap, and every series is having a range of wavelength. So these ranges of wavelength were called as packets of energy, and there was energy gap in between them. This is clearly explained by Bohr, that the hydrogen exhibits a discrete spectrum based upon these series, based upon the value of N1 and N2. Also, here we can see that the value of first energy level, ground state, is most negative. That means here in the ground state, an electron is having its minimum energy. It is in its most stable state. That means we can take the example of if someone is living at ground state, that person must be giving, if someone is living at the ground floor of the house and is paying the maximum rent. So here also, electron is paying the maximum rent to the nucleus. That means it is in depth of maximum energy. So if we want to take out this electron, we want to ionize this electron, we'll have to supply large amount of energy to overcome this energy barrier. And if we want to take out this electron for N3, the energy supplied is to be equal to make it zero, we need to supply 1.51 electron volt of energy per atom. So this is all about the line spectrum of hydrogen, how these radiations are produced, how the wavelength varies. We can calculate the wavelength ranges. We can such type of questions are generally asked in competitive exams, that calculate the wavelength of first line of Lyman series, or calculate the energy of first line of Lyman series. So first line of Lyman series would be where N2 is 2 and N1 is 1. For Lyman series, N1 is always 1. N2 is going to vary. That is the level from where the electron is jumping back. So first line would be given by N2 is equal to 2, and the last line would be given by N2 is equal to infinite. So if we put both these values, then we can get the range of the wavelength obtained for Lyman series, and we can also calculate the corresponding energies using this formula. This is the formula. This is how we can calculate all these energies associated and wavelength associated with all these series of lines. First series is called as Lyman series, then Balmer, then Parchin, then Bracket, then Pfund, and then the last one is, for which N1 is equal to 6, is Humphrey series. These are very important. This topic is very important from the point of view of the NEET exam and your JEE mains exam. Also, sometimes you are asked in competitive exams that how many number of lines are obtained for, you are given the two values for N1 and N2, you are given the value of N1 and N2, and you are asked about the number of lines obtained from these transitions. So by using this formula, you can easily calculate the number of lines produced. Say we want to calculate the number of lines being produced from, if N2 is 2 and N1 is 1. Here 2 minus 1 is equal to 1. 2 minus 1 plus 1 means 2. 2 by 2 is 1. Only one line is going to be obtained for if electron is jumping back from the second level to the first level. You can calculate the number of lines for any of the level if the electron is jumping from seventh level back to the ground state, for which N2 is going to be 7. 7 minus 1 is 6. 7 minus 1, that means 6 into 7 divided by 2. 6 into 7 is 42 divided by 2. That means 21 lines are going to be obtained for this. Next was the failure of Bohr model. Now the this was the Bohr model which also failed. This model also failed. Although it gave so many successful things. It explained the hydrogen spectrum. It gave the formula for first Bohr orbit, for radius of first Bohr orbit, energy of different energy levels. But still, it also failed. The first thing which led to its failure was the Max Planck theory of light. When the Max Planck in 1905 proved the light, the nature of light as particle, he gave the concept of photon or the quanta accord. And his theory was called as quantum theory. Both Einstein and Max Planck were working on this theory. Both of them proved that light exhibits dual nature, that is wave nature. The wave nature of light was already acceptable, but they proved the particle nature of light in the form of tiny packets called quanta or photon. And energy value was equal to, based upon that, h into nu. Here nu is frequency. Further, energy formula given by them, where they related the energy value with wavelength and speed of light, that is energy is equal to hc by lambda. This relation was given by Einstein. Here the value of h, now with this value of h is acceptable, but it is continuously changing, it is continuously getting refined by the scientists. So based upon this experiment, this invention of light as particle nature by Max Planck and Einstein, De Broglie was a French national who got the idea, he gave the hypothesis that just like light, particles are also going to have wave nature in addition to the particle nature. Based upon this, he proposed the electrons to have the wave nature. So he proposed the wave nature of electron based upon his hypothesis. He got this idea based upon the Max Planck and Einstein's theory. So he proposed that electron has a dual nature, and which was further proved by Davison and Germer experiment, because in their experiment the electrons exhibited the diffraction pattern which was generally exhibited by X-rays, which are having wave nature. So based upon that, they proposed that electrons are also having wave nature in addition to their particle nature, which was already proved based upon the invention experiment of electrons, where scintillations were produced on the fluorescent screen placed at back of the anode in the cathode ray experiment. So this was the De Broglie's hypothesis. Here the name of the scientist, that De Broglie, he's a French national, so the pronunciation of his name is De Broglie. In India, we pronounce it as De Broglie, but it is wrong. The pronunciation of this name is De Broglie. So this hypothesis was first proposed for electrons, but then it was extended to every particle, even the macroscopic particles. So based upon this hypothesis, he proposed that all moving particles are having dual nature, that is particle and wave. And he called the waves associated with the matter, or he called them as matter waves, for which wavelength was given by h upon mv. H upon mass into velocity, where h is Planck's constant, mass is the mass of the body which we are talking about, the matter which we are talking about, v is the velocity of that matter. Or we can say h upon p. This formula is based upon the Max Planck and Einstein theory. Now coming to the significance of De Broglie's relationship. Now the question arises that why cannot we see the big particles moving in the form of a wave? If wave nature is associated with macroscopic particles also, then we should experience the macroscopic particles just like a cricket ball. I have taken the example of a cricket ball here. That cricket ball is moving in the form of a wave, just like electrons, which we cannot see, but we should be able to see the wave nature of cricket ball based upon this hypothesis. Let us calculate the wavelength based upon that. In general, we can take the mass of a cricket ball as 100 grams. V is the velocity. Suppose it is moving with the velocity of 20 meters per second. From here, if we calculate the lambda, this comes out to be 3.313 10 raised to power minus 2, 24 angstrom. And for electron, lambda comes out to be 3.2 angstrom. Here, this value is very small. The wavelength for the cricket ball is very small, that it is even smaller than any electromagnetic radiation known so far. So, based upon this, although wave nature is associated with the macroscopic particles, but we cannot see such wavelengths. These are beyond the range of human, that we cannot experience, we cannot relate to this wavelength. This is even smaller than EM radiation wavelength. We cannot see the electromagnetic radiation. So how can we see these radiations? That is why cricket ball doesn't appear to us moving in the form of a wave. So De Broglie hypothesis, HT stands for hypothesis here, is valid for microscopic particles only. It is valid for macroscopic particles also, but it is significant for hydroscopic particles only. So every microscopic moving particle is a wave whose wavelength is given by H upon mv. This formula was based upon the formula given by Einstein and Planck's proposal, that is E is equal to hc by lambda. Also, energy is equal to mc square as given by Einstein's mass energy relationship. From here, we can derive the value or the relation given by the De Broglie, that if we equate both these equations, h nu is equal to mc square. From here, lambda is equal to h upon mc, where c is the velocity of light. And if we replace c by the velocity of any matter which we are talking about, then we come to this equation, which was the De Broglie equation. So justification for De Broglie hypothesis, particle nature was already justified as electrons possess particle nature due to definite mass, charge, as everything was known at that time. Everything was invented: mass, charge, energy, momentum. So the particle nature was already established for the electrons, and wave nature was established by Revson and Germer experiment. In their experiment, this is a setup of their experiment. What they did was they chose the electron beam coming out of, and they applied the electric field for accelerating this electron beam, and they irradiate the nickel crystal, some crystalline material, with the electron beam. And what they observed, that they observed a diffraction pattern which was very similar to those obtained by X-rays. If we irradiate this nickel crystal with X-rays, similar diffraction pattern was obtained. Diffraction pattern means concentric light and dark rings. This shaded portion is the dark region, and non-shaded region, which is here, which I am coloring as yellow, except the inner circle, which is also shaded, and the outer shell of the inner circle is the light region. Then comes the dark region, then the light region. So this is the concentric electron diffraction rings were obtained, similar to X-rays, when electron beam was used. So based upon this, De Broglie suggested that electron is also having wave nature. Revson German proved the wave nature of electrons. Now, if we want to estimate the De Broglie's wavelength, from where did it came? Electron E is accelerated. We are accelerating the electron by a potential difference of E. that based upon what here nickel crystal is being irradiated. Let me explain it further. Here nickel crystal is being irradiated. So when nickel crystal is irradiated, the diffraction pattern is produced. So this phenomenon is nowadays is used for the description of the crystal structure. So how this is used, this is based upon this calculation that the potential energy of the electron which is excited, which is accelerated by the potential V, capital V, here half mv square is the formula of kinetic energy, both are equal. From here we can calculate the value of velocity and we'll put the value of velocity in this equation, which comes out to be this. From here, putting the values of these constants, we can calculate the value of lambda. And now if we apply the potential of 1 kV to this, in this experiment where we are applying the potential difference here. So if 1 kV potential is applied, that means the wavelength comes out to be 38.8 picometers, which is comparable to the bond length of the different molecules. So from here we got the idea that we can study the molecular structures, we can use this phenomenon for the determination of the molecular structure of different molecules, as wavelength is comparable to the bond length. Now we can easily differentiate between the matter waves and electromagnetic waves. For the electromagnetic waves, it is already well known that here. For the electromagnetic waves, we already know that there is associated perpendicular electric and magnetic field, but with the matter waves, no such electric or magnetic field is associated. These can be radiated into space or emitted. These are associated with the matter. These are just associated with the matter. These cannot be radiated into space or emitted. Electromagnetic waves do not require any medium for their propagation, but matter requires medium for the propagation, as these are associated with matter and matter requires medium. Speed associated with the light is, or we can say electromagnetic radiation, is 3×10⁸ meter per second, and it can never be equal to this. It is always less than the speed of matter, is always less than this. Formula for wavelength is h upon mc, and for matter waves the formula for wavelength is h upon mv, where v is the velocity of matter and c is the velocity of light. Also, based upon this de Broglie hypothesis, the Bohr postulate that angular momentum is quantized. Bohr just took it as condition and derived this equation, but based upon de Broglie's hypothesis, this how he reached here, how to reach here, this was explained. So according to de Broglie, if we consider an electron moving around the nucleus in a circular orbit in the form of a wave, say here, electron is moving in the form of a wave in a circular orbit. So this is the circular orbit and electron is moving in the form of a wave. Now this wave can be in phase or out of phase. If it is not in phase, that means it is going to collapse. So it should be in phase. That means this is a stationary wave. If some wave is in phase, that means it will appear to us as stationary wave or standing wave. So if we start from this point, we can calculate how many waves are there, how many wavelengths are there. That is one complete trough and complete crest. It makes one here, two here. I'll mark these points, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the 5. This was our starting point. So here we can see that 5 wavelengths are there. So the circumference is equal to 2 pi r, and circumference of the orbit can be equated to, where n comes out to be 5. We have counted it 5. If the circumference is big, then the value of n will be high. So here, which I have drawn, the value of n comes out to be 5. So we can equate it to any integer, as it is going to be an integer only. So it is equal to n lambda, as This is one wave and wavelength is lambda. 2 pi r is equal to n lambda. From here, if we put the value of lambda as equal to h upon mv, then 2 pi r is equal to nh upon mv, and from here mvr is separated and mvr is our angular momentum, which comes to be equal to nh upon 2 pi, which was the quantization condition of Bohr. So from here, based upon the de Broglie's hypothesis, quantization condition of Bohr was also established. So some things on the Bohr model were acceptable and some of the things were challenged based upon de Broglie and Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So the next thing which led to the failure of Bohr atomic model was Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. According to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, it is not possible to determine from simultaneously both the position and momentum of any microscopic particle with absolute accuracy. But according to the Bohr, he calculates the value of energy and also the radius of the first Bohr orbit he calculated. So he calculated the position and momentum both with accuracy. He didn't show that there was any error, but according to Heisenberg, there was error associated with both these quantities, that the error is always greater than or equal to h upon 4 pi when we calculate position, and when we try to calculate position and momentum simultaneously, the error is going to be always greater than or equal to h upon 4 pi. If we take here delta x is equal to 0, that means error in position, that we can that we determine the position accurately, where delta x comes out to be 0, then that means delta p is going to be infinite, which is not possible that anything associated with infinite amount of energy. So this is true, that error associated with both the things is always greater than h upon 4 pi. Let us see the physical concept associated with this statement given by Heisenberg. If we talk about macroscopic particles, say a ball, again a cricket ball, if we strike it with a photon of energy, that means if we strike it with light or photon of energy, which is having energy, so energy of the photon will be transferred to the ball, but it will not bring any change in the position or velocity of the ball if it is already moving. Thus, both can be determined with accuracy. So, this Heisenberg uncertainty principle is associated with the microscopic particles. Here, this is the condition for Heisenberg uncertainty principle, that we cannot find both these things simultaneously for microscopic particles. Now, if we talk about the microscopic particle, say an electron, if it is moving in its circular orbit as adjusted by Bohr, and we strike it with a photon, what will happen? If we want to know the position of the electron and the angular momentum, we'll strike it with photon. We want to see, we will supply, we'll put light on this, and it will gain energy. Once it strikes with the photon, it will gain energy and it will change its path. And this arrow is showing its new path. So, but the expected path was this. So it has changed its position and now the position is lost if we have calculated the angular momentum associated. So once the photon strikes the electron, it will gain energy and change its path and thus change its energy. So it is not possible to determine both the things simultaneously. In our daily life, we do not come across microscopic objects. So this Heisenberg uncertainty principle is not valid in our daily life. Also, this is a fundamental limitation of nature. This cannot be rectified or this cannot be improved based upon the refined techniques, as this is the law of nature. We cannot challenge this law. Electron, based upon the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, it can be explained that electron cannot exist in the nucleus. How this is explained? Say the radius of the nucleus is of the order of 10 raised to power minus 15 meters. So for an electron to stay in nucleus, delta x cannot be assessed cannot be more than 10 raised to the power minus 15 meters. So if we take uncertainty in position as 10 raised to the power minus 15, from here we can calculate, and we know the that delta P is equal to, which is momentum, this is equal to mass into velocity, and mass of electrons we already know. From here, velocity we can calculate, all these values are constant and we know the value of delta x. From here, velocity comes out to be 5.77 into 10 raised to power 10 meter per second. But and this velocity which is coming, this error in velocity which is coming from this calculation, is greater than the speed of light, and nothing can have speed greater than the speed of light so far. So this is not possible. So that is why we cannot, that is why electron can never exist in nucleus. So this was explained on the basis of Heisenberg uncertainty principle. This is a very important question from the point of view of exam, that explain based upon uncertainty principle why electron cannot exist in nucleus, and you will have to show the following calculation. So now we come to the drawbacks of Bohr's model. So Bohr's model was valid for single electron species, as it single electron species like hydrogen or hydrogen like atoms, the atoms which loses some electrons in the form and become ions, and number of electrons associated with those ions is equal to 1, just like lithium 2 positive, helium 2 positive, helium positive, beryllium 3 positive. So these are hydrogen-like atoms. So Bohr model was valid for such atoms only. Bohr considered electron to be, to have the particle nature. It didn't consider the dual nature of electron, that is wave nature and the particle nature both. Bohr measured position of electron and velocity of electron with certainty. But based upon Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, these both these things cannot be determined with certainty. There is always an error associated with them, as given by Heisenberg. The spectral lines observed by Bohr were further split in the presence of magnetic field, and those effects, when the spectral lines split in the presence of magnetic field, that effect is called as Riemann effect. And when the spectral lines that got split in the presence of electric field, that effect is called as Stark effect. These two effects were not explained by Bohr. Also, the ultrafine spectrum could not be explained upon, based upon the Bohr model. So next model which came into existence, which is still acceptable, was the, which challenged the Bohr atomic model, which was an improvement to the Bohr atomic model, and which is still acceptable, is the wave mechanical model of the atom, or the quantum mechanical model. This model we'll be discussing in our next video. That is it for this video. I hope you have understood many points and you have found it interesting. I'll be giving you some numericals to solve based upon the Heisenberg's and De Broglie's relationship in the next video. So that is it for this video. Thank you so much.